Well, it's Sunday again on the weekend, so we're going to take care of some weekend business here at S&S Turbines. We're checking in on Shop Kitty. She's pretty vocal. More importantly, you'll notice that the J47s are gone and the J79 is in the test cell, which means it won't be long. We've got Electron Bill in our booth and we've got our afterburning J79. What we're going to do is we're going to test the afterburner torch igniter ignition plug. It's at the bottom at the 6 o'clock position down in here. Okay, Bill, hit it. Oh, awesome. Now that is what starts the torch igniter, which shoots flame into the afterburner tube, which ignites the fuel and makes the afterburner run. That's quite a huge spark. Excellent. Stay tuned.
Now that is the sound of a healthy afterburner igniter.
Well, it was. And thank you for saying that, Mr. Bill.
I didn't know I was on.
That's Electron Bill. He'll be on hand for the test of the afterburning J79. It's going to be fun. Look at that thing. And there she is. That's one big long engine, isn't it? Well, now that we have the back door open, we got some light in here. We can see the afterburner igniter, the torch igniter of our J79. It's right at the 6 o'clock position, looking straight at you. And you can look right down in there and see there's a fuel nozzle and an igniter inside it. It has a separate fuel supply and ignition supply. Let's see if I can zoom in there. Hang on. There, can you see that? There's an igniter and a fuel nozzle inside the torch igniter for the afterburner. It looks very familiar. It looks a lot like a 1500, an LM1500, because the core of both engines is exactly the same. Exactly the same. These cylinders are fed fuel pressure at 400 PSI and they are controlled and they actuate the mechanism which changes the diameter of the nozzle, the jet thrust nozzle. Right now it's in the fully open position for zero thrust at idle. This is also the running position for full afterburner. Full power without afterburner, it'll close down quite a bit for the appropriate area for maximum acceleration of the exhaust gases. We have to hook a few things up and get a few things made, but it will be running, making noise very soon. Now, I've just spent the last half hour making a violent driving indicator. That's what you start with, a titanium compressor blade that has a little bit of damage. This is what you come out with. This one is for, wait, where's his name? There he is. Q123477 in Strongsville, Ohio. And he sent me some trinkets in trade, a beer cozy. I guess this is their mascot, Brutus, the Ohio State Buckeyes. Now, I'm wondering, those look like pot leaves. They can't be. No, they can't be. And there's the Ohio State badge. Okay, how do you get here? You use all these rags, two pairs of gloves, some oil. This is that letter number oil, and some metal polish. We like to use Mother's jet engine part polish. Anyway, you spend about 15 minits with the 1200 grit sandpaper. Oh, that's 600. Okay, 600 to 1200 will work. 600's faster. And you polish and you polish and you polish and you polish with the alphanumeric oil. And you clean it, then you polish it again and again and again and again and again. And the more that you do it with the sandpaper, the nicer it comes out with the metal polish. The last thing you do after sandpapering it is degrease it completely, which is why you switch to another set of gloves. We use a degreaser, get them squeaky dry and clean. Then you use the metal polish and then buff it hard with a clean cotton rag. This has turned out nice, but if you really want to go crazy, you can make it like a mirror, although that takes probably an hour of elbow grease and sweat. This is a VDI because it's got the hole for hanging off the mirror. And I trimmed off the ugly bit, the mangled, FOD damaged compressor. These are from the same stage though. The same stage. And there you go. This is a full-size, truck-size VDI. You can make them smaller for cars out of the later stages. Thanks for watching, and thanks for the goodies. Q123477. See ya.